There's nothing so powerful as an idea whose time has come. The old idea that gravity is the only force in the universe is slowly giving way to an understanding of how electromagnetic forces also operate in the star systems of space. I'm making this video to show why this new electric universe cosmology is more than just another scientific theory. In what follows, you'll see how it's the key to a whole new age of humanity, as major as the Bronze Age or the Stone Age. It is quite literally an idea that will change the world. All societies and all concepts of personal and cultural development are based on mythologies. The study of mythologies, how they are classified, what they signify, and how they change and grow, is called mythography. The whole human story, like the atoms of our own little stories that comprise it, is framed according to mythic themes and archetypes. As a mythographer, I focus on deep culture change in professional, educational, organisational and global contexts. I want to understand how we carve the building blocks of meaning from the raw material of experience, and how we use them to construct the mythological architecture of a whole world view and way of life as individuals, groups, and societies. Getting a handle on that whole process is important if we want to adapt to the imperatives of new realities. Most people dismiss myths as just a bunch of stories of snake-haired women and bull-headed men, tall tales unworthy of serious adult attention. But people in government, marketing, movies, and news media know and use the power of myth. Myths are symbolic stories that amplify a mythology. A mythology is not just a bunch of stories, though. A mythology is a complete worldview containing a whole value system and enabling us to attach meaning to experience. It helps us set our bearings. It's our basic field guide to being in and with the world. A mythology is transmitted in a society by way of inherited themes called memes. And these memes change, evolving or mutating over time like a message in a game of Chinese whispers. As a mythographer, I'm also interested in this dynamic systems and processes of this transmission and transition of mythology. In this short film, I will show how, from the perspective of mythography, electric universe cosmology can be seen as the key we've been waiting for to unlock all the positive potentials of a new human age and focus all its parts into a cohesive whole to wedge and shift the otherwise insurmountable problems and blockages currently facing us as individuals, groups, and societies. Or, put another way, the emerging values and practical alternatives in today's society are subgroups that share the same heading. They all cohere around electric universe cosmology, just as surely as rubbed amber pulls light. To understand why electric universe cosmology is so central to the emergence of this quantum leap in human consciousness, we must first consider the kind of problems such a leap would have to solve. The first decade and a half of the new millennium has been marked by the growth of so-called wicked problems, complex problems that can't be solved but require ongoing management. In particular, we find wicked problems right at the very heart of society. Education, health, finance, food, water, energy, housing, ecology, social justice, and so on. These impossibly complex problems proliferate because society is based on an out-of-date mythology. When the mythology that a society is based on cannot keep up with the changes in people's life experience, we get disorientation and dysfunction. A kind of social subsidence occurs. You may be astonished to learn that Bronze Age man still stalks the streets to this day, for we are still living with the memes of Bronze Age mythology. With exponential information growth and huge changes in demography, mobility, work patterns, economy, technology, and communications, we've moved on a lot since the Bronze Age, but our mythology hasn't. What happens if a house slips away from its foundations? And the situation is that stark. When we consider some of the memes that serve as pillars of Bronze Age mythology, it becomes clear why our world seems on the brink of collapse, beset by such a plethora of wicked problems. Bronze Age mythology is heroic. In the archetype cycle of human development, the hero is not fully mature, but is typically a testosterone-driven male. The mythographer Joseph Campbell presents the hero as a kind of full flowering of the male psyche, and he may be right, for we all flower before we mature. The hero thinks nothing of rushing a bunker full of machine gunners, bare-chested if possible, only to emerge wiping the blade of his knife, having dispatched them all forthwith, if he emerges at all. If our hero is one of the tiny few who actually do survive the impossible, he is then able to move on to the next archetype, that of the warrior, a survivor par excellence who knows endurance, appreciates the fleeting fragility of life, and has lost all the rash bravado of the prior phase. Bronze Age mythology has always been linked to tragedy. We find it in all the earliest records, from the Bible to Homer and the classics. What is there about Bronze Age mind that connotes tragedy? Let's see. Heroic Bronze Age mythology has five core memes: separation, grouping, contest, conquest, and acquisition. Let's consider these briefly in turn. The separation meme begins with Bronze Age technology and logistics, the separation of metal from rock to make bronze, and the use of materials from distant source locations, typically copper from Cyprus with tin from England. There was always a kind of tension about bronze, leaving us with a tricky circle to square. However much we may combine tin and copper in statues and weapons, their separate sources make it impossible to control production without an empire covering both sources. This tension sets the aggressive tone of expansion, trade, and industry, and resonates with other manifestations of Bronze Age culture and mythology. The Cartesian objectivity of the Renaissance, that rebirth of Bronze Age classical culture, set us apart from nature, and ideally above it. In that mindset, we see the world as ranged before us and all about us, but we remain subspecie aeternitatis, permanently detached from the circle of life, and therefore alienated. In our time, the separation meme of Bronze Age mythology, with all its aggressive tensions, can be seen in the increasing polarization of social division, ethnic, gender and generational division, workplace silos, separation from nature, and general psychological alienation, which Freud says we all suffer from. Not only does separation hinder our ability to relate to others on many levels, it undermines our authenticity to the extent that we can't even relate to ourselves. We may have egalitarian or meritocratic values, but every time we shop, use a bank account, or pay taxes, part of us knows deep down that we're actually investing in global war, Amazon deforestation, and child slavery. It's profoundly corrupting going against our own values like that by default. It undermines our self-belief, making frauds of us all. Broadly speaking, this separation meme manifests in a dualistic or oppositional mindset of self and other, mind and body, light and dark, sacred and profane, etc. It divides and separates the individual from others and from themselves. Being separated out as some kind of special or chosen one has never been comfortable. Grouping is the other side of that old Bronze Age coin. On one side it's self and other, and on the reverse it's us and them. Grouping. It's wherever we see an attitude of our group is different from yours and is better, is more favoured by God, is stronger, cleverer, and so on. Initially, this we-oriented meme may have held potential for human advancement by leading to increased unity, but that's not a target we'd be likely to reach by this route because of how it's been applied, more to exclude than to include. We can see this grouping in the very combining of materials that make bronze. That's how Bronze Age it is. It's all about the extension of properties and extending the ego's reach to the other. It implies a desire to lose the self in the group. It's like a Freudian feast of Oedipus and Electra complexes, a skewed misfiring of the healthy desire for completeness and union with all cosmic existence, but one that remains ego-bound and therefore exclusive. This whole misdirected will to extend our reach by a proxy of the group is also connected to the psychology of insatiable power hunger, as if it were worth killing the world to own it. The story of Babylon's famous tower is a good illustration of man's attempt to ascend to the universal. We failed and split into groups. Politics, money, and media are the tools of the alphas, who were seduced and corrupted by power as Babel rose higher, using us for cannon fodder in their turf wars. In modern times, this grouping theme gives us rigid systems of classification, social stratification, and distribution of labour. Most significantly, it gives us armies, teams, gangs, factionalism, dogma, organised religions and cartels, and the groupthink mentality that goes with it, where we abrogate responsibility for our own actions in the name of the group. We can all think of examples of that mentality, where someone does something crappy and takes no responsibility for it, saying, "I was only following orders," or "I'm sorry, that's just the company policy," or whatever. That's all a result of the Bronze Age grouping meme, warping over time. The next meme of our Bronze Age mythology is contest. Right from the early Bronze Age, we find tales of fierce rivalry for contested land, resources, power, and influence. From ancient Ilium to ancient Israel. Contest is not equal to competition, though. With competition, the focus is on increasing excellence, but with a contesting mindset, the focus is on conflict. The Latin word competere, competition in English, means striving together for a shared goal, and has nothing to do with defeating others who lose. The original competitive Olympian ethos was very different from a Roman gladiatorial contest. The clue is in those circles being linked together like that. The contest meme in Bronze Age mythology is seen today in the adrenaline-fueled dog-eat-dog hustle and rush of urban society. This meme was crystallized in the Darwinian notion of the survival of the fittest, especially as seen through the lens of Nietzsche's will to power, and is now the ubiquitous dominant influence in almost all societies, most obviously in business, in the workplace, and in our adversarial judicial system. The next meme is conquest. You can probably already guess the kind of thing that applies here. This one's all about supremacy, empire building, domination, exploitation, and enslavement. Essentially, taking from others. On the face of it, conquest may seem to be about control of economic resources, but it's more radical than contest. Its ultimate aim is a kind of mind control, the control of meaning, by imposing your mythology on others. That arrow in the eye wasn't just the end of Harold. It marked the end of Harold's whole worldview. An early Bronze Age example from ancient Greece would be Apollo's mythical slaying of the serpent at Delphi, conquering and usurping the ancient matriarchal oracle there with a new system of patriarchal domination for a new mindset to take hold. We see the same in the switch from demonized paganism to idealized monotheism and elsewhere. Throughout ancient mythologies, we see battling conquerors like Apollo celebrated and deified, from the Gita to Homer, and from Caesar to the monotheists' holy books. The centrality of today's military-industrial complex in the global economy, as the biggest single employer and money spinner in the world, with PR by the Hollywood propaganda machine, points to the importance of this Bronze Age pillar today. The increasing trend towards treating women and children as direct military targets is particularly worrying. That's about as extreme as things can get. War rape of mind-bending brutality in Europe, Africa, Asia, and the Middle East is now a common practice, which is extending into targeting children in schools, with almost 10,000 attacks on schools in recent years, including the loss of many hundreds in Pakistan, Sudan, Nigeria, and Kenya. There are a million such horror stories. This predatory targeting of women, which has recently mutated into targeting children, is a direct legacy of Bronze Age mythology, where women first became seen as objects, as first reported by Homer. around 1000 BCE. Helen of Troy, Cassandra, Penelope, Homer is full of examples. We can see it all the way through the Greeks and Romans to the Vikings and the Goths, to the Serbians, the Sudanese. Despite or because of the emotive impact of such dehumanizing objectification, we often see advertising flirting with danger by promoting the idea of woman and children as prey object. Is that just part of human nature? Was objectifying and abusing mothers and children common practice before the Bronze Age? In the Pyramid Age or the Stone Age, for instance? Or was the Delphic matriarchy that Apollo overturned unlikely to promote such values and practices? A single day without military manoeuvres or production would save enough money to permanently feed and house all the people on this planet. The UN isn't bothered about this, and advertising has shown its colours. Clearly, such humanity is not consistent with the old established order of Bronze Age mind. The final meme in Bronze Age mythology that I want to mention, and the one served by all the others mentioned so far, is acquisition. Acquisition is the ultimate goal, written all over the face of society. This Midas craving to have and consume more at the expense of others is pointed to by one of Freud's leading students, Eric Fromm, in his book To Have or To Be. It is rooted in a deep-seated sense of unease and insecurity. This insecurity behind the desire for material acquisitiveness, this dis-ease that makes us so insatiably greedy, leads to a demand for instant gratification, which opens the door to the torment of addictions of all sorts. First, you separate from oneness. Then you group up into factions. Then you contest meaning. Then you conquer. And finally, you own, define, and consume everything. That's the Bronze Age mythology in a nutshell. This brief profile of heroic Bronze Age mythology shows a mindset marked by torment, insecurity, will to power, Oedipal complexes, factionalism, materialistic greed, and dualistic alienation. In its time, it was a crucial step in human development, but in our time, it is seriously threatening the future of human and earthly life. It is information rich, but meaning poor. It covers our entire existence, but it's so full of holes, it offers more threat than protection. It is swollen with pride in its entrenchment and beggars belief that we might let ourselves die out rather than mature. The whole situation has become untenable. Change is necessary and inevitable. The only question remaining is what kind of change will we see, which depends on the kind of seeds we sow now. That about sums up the challenges to be addressed by any new age in human development. We're halfway through the video, so now for the good news. Let's take a look at how the electric universe solves some of these old problems of Bronze Age mythology. Back in the 60s, Thomas Kuhn wrote a seminal work entitled The Structure of Scientific Revolutions. It introduces the idea of paradigms in physical and social sciences and outlines the process by which these paradigms change. Kuhn describes how scientific revolutions occur by a process he calls paradigm shift. New understandings and practices gradually fill the holes in the old paradigm until it reaches a tipping point where a new paradigm emerges, overturning and replacing the old one. We've seen a whole host of physical and social scientific revolutions in our own lifetime all over the place. But what is it that has held so many of them back from completing their big picture potential till now? Why don't we have free and renewable energy in our homes with pollution-free cars running on free energy? Why no widespread growth of small-scale organic food production? Why hunger and constant war? Why still racism and sexism? Why is education and even democracy itself held back from the profound and enlightened recasting we are now capable of? Why still a global financial system of perpetual debt slavery? Why still a growing wealth gap already so polarized that it implies two completely different species? We already have all the alternatives we need to see a broad front of scientific revolutions with the combined potential to add up to millennial social change. So why isn't the longed-for change swinging into action and sweeping the world? What exactly is keeping all this great potential from becoming kinetic? How did we get diverted from the brave new road to utopian ideals onto today's cowardly dystopian superhighway? Obvious and endlessly debatable conspiracy theories aside, there's a profound answer to why this wave of scientific revolutions has not fully flowered. It comes via Carl Jung's assertion that mankind has lost its sense of cosmological belonging. In other words, according to Jung, people feel like they do not belong in and with the world, even as if they are alien to the whole cosmos, or the cosmos is alien to them. A sense of cosmological belonging is the basis of all attempts to make meaning, and conversely, the lack of cosmological belonging in today's world pulls us into a black hole vortex of nihilism, where nothing means anything at all, thus driving the lack of belonging to dizzying new depths all the time. This is fundamentally disorienting, making people suggestible and easily manipulated. And yes, cosmological orientation is precisely what the electric universe theory provides. Mythography shows how all social and cultural organizing principles stem from cosmology, starting with the concepts of time, form, geometry, and number, with values and behavior systems growing entwined, almost like the twin snakes in an electric filament to shed light on meaning. These organizing principles, values, and behaviors comprise the fabric of human life. It follows, then, that if we get the cosmology right, all the things under it will unfold as they should. Of course, we can never know we have the cosmology all right. There may be too many unknowables, but it needs to be credible and cohesive and to fit right with the needs of our historical context. The electric universe model satisfies these conditions, and it may even be right, the whole story, for all we can know. The unfolding of the fabric of humanity under new skies, under the cosmology of the electric universe, includes the freeing up of all the alternatives sitting up our sleeves. All we need to do is roll them up. The electric universe is the keystone to the arc of change. It's the only thing that can hold the whole triumphal arch together. It only remains to look briefly at some of the key indicators of how the electric universe theory fits with our new social and cultural context, to assess how it fits with our current state of knowledge and needs, and to outline its relevance to emerging scientific revolutions. As I said at the beginning of this video, the electric universe theory brings to the table the idea that gravity is not the only force active in the cosmos. It points to the indisputable electromagnetic forces of the stars and planets and states the obvious, that electricity, or electromagnetism to give it its full name, is also present in the cosmos. Gravity is a very weak force. It takes the gravitational force of our entire planet to make a spoon stay on a table. But electromagnetism is such a strong force that a small magnet can easily overpower the force of gravity and pick up the spoon. Electric universe theory shows the unity of all being, our cells, our brains, our bodies, our planet, the solar system, the stars and the galaxies all involve electrical processes. Let's take a look at how this pans out in relation to assessing the suitability of electric universe as a cosmology on which to base a new mythology. We find quite a different kind of architecture with electric universe mythology than with the Bronze Age mythology. Firstly, it's no longer located in the Bronze Age stage of human development. It's not heroic or tragic. It's got beyond that. Second, it's not based on a number of pillars, like the separation, grouping, contest, conquest, and acquisition of the Bronze Age mind. It's a unifying arc, a bond of bright presence, a covenant of universal connectivity. Electric mind is the circuitry of the entire archetype cycle. There are no memes like separateness, grouping, and so on. It is the meme. And that meme is all about connectivity. The mechanics of electric mind, as implied by the electric universe theory, is simply one of on or off, like the binary code in computers, like the synaptic firing in our brains. This connectivity principle is the hub for converging paradigm shifts in all key areas of scientific and social development. Here's just a sample. Physics. In physics, the connectivity principle allows for what I call immediacy, regardless of location. According to relativity theory, nothing travels faster than light, which is a bit of a problem when we know that subatomic particles like bosons and neutrinos actually do travel faster than light, which means in effect that time travel is possible. Recent work in China has shown that quantum interaction is at least 10,000 times faster than light. An event thousands of light years away can have an instantaneous effect here. Einstein suspected as much himself and was well aware of what he called spooky action at a distance. He knew his equation E equals mc squared only applied to objects moving relative to each other, and was not a proof of an energy-matter connection, but of an energy-matter-momentum connection. Post-Einstein, Bell's theorem of non-local effects shows how events are linked faster than light or superluminal, regardless of time and space. Bell's theorem opens the possibility that beyond our senses, everything may exist everywhere in an eternal ocean stream of pure being, which we just dip into to experience snapshots at specific locations in space-time. Bell's findings have been confirmed every time they've been tested by other physicists. This aspect of immediacy signals potential for a new mythological framework that replaces the survival of the fittest ethos of evolutionist naturalism with the more socially aware ethos of unity, pointed to in the old African proverb, "If you want to travel fast, travel alone. If you want to travel far, travel together." Ecology. Our increasing understanding of the interdependent symbiosis of our ecosystem, that incredibly fine and complex web of earthly life, strains at the leash of traditional academic compartmentalism, but it resonates with the connectivity of the electric universe. This replaces the whole idea of evolving to survive in a hostile and therefore alien environment with a self-dynamic, unified system. As Berkeley astrophysicist and futures consultant to 20 governments, Eric Jansch, put it, it is not adaptation to a given environment that signals a unified overall evolution, but the co-evolution of system and environment at all levels, the co-evolution of micro and macrocosmos. Such an overall evolution is indeterminate, self-consistent, and creative. Such a system is inherently holistic, revealing similar patterns on all scales, like zooming into the Mandelbrot set. Our chemistry and our cells are stimulated and agitated as a complex product of electromagnetic currents, just as we ourselves experience stimulation and agitation, and just as the planet does, and the galaxy. That is why when Munch melts in a scream, the very sky melts with him. That is why Massarel's starry sky pulsates with the longing of the city, the yearning of the lonely. In humanities, radical revisions of ancient history face similar obstacles of academic compartmentalism, with the added weight of academic dogma and the outright denial of rock-hard evidence. Yet they offer much to our understanding of mythic representations of world-changing events, including those caused by cosmic electrical phenomena, such as those pointed to by Emmanuel Velikovsky and David Talbot. If we don't know where we come from, how can we know where we should be headed? In working towards credible, non-conventional theories of history that plug the gaps in conventional wisdom, writers like Hancock and West keep alive the all-important ember of possibility that we may one day feel like we belong and like we understand the purpose of our being here, because we feel like we actually know at last what and where we come from. Interdisciplinary work and collaboration. There's a general consensus that silo thinking stifles innovation by prohibiting joined-up thinking, holding us back in all kinds of ways, including business, professional, and academic. There's a pervading sense that we need to think more broadly, out of the box, taking a more interdisciplinary and collaborative approach. Again, there's the connectivity of electric universe at the root of new thinking. The past two decades have seen a huge increase in collaborative work, especially on social entrepreneurial projects. This is supported by a flood of online e-collaboration tools. The connectivity of electric universe is also inherently interdisciplinary, just like the man who inspired the idea of electric universe, Einstein's friend, Immanuel Velikovsky. Velikovsky was a psychologist turned ancient historian turned astronomer extraordinaire who accurately predicted Jupiter's extraordinary electromagnetic field, among other things. Work life. We're now experiencing huge changes in the ways that work is done. Gone are the days of a job for life. Not only can we expect to have many more jobs in our lifetime now than before, but today's youth can even expect to have up to 5 different professional careers spread across a 55-year work life. The new paradigm here is portfolio life, where paid work is seen as just one part of the personal economy equation. The growth of portfolio life, especially prevalent among knowledge-based professionals, frees workers to realise their full value by enabling them to use all their wide range of competences and experience in a diverse range of activities, more or less according to their own preference. My own portfolio, for example, enables me to leverage my competences in teaching, storytelling, writing books for business, novel writing, teacher training, consulting, lecturing, youth work, charity work, and playing music. I play jazz. Try and find a mix like that in an old-fashioned job. The connectivity of the electric universe resonates with the modern professionals connecting all the parts of their work-life value within a single portfolio. This liberating trend stimulates economic dynamism in the spirit of innovation and entrepreneurialism that often accompanies it. And it is also attractive to companies who can hire people to do jobs of work without having to employ them full-time. Win-win. Also in the world of work, we see a looming paradigm shift in management systems towards what Gary Hamel calls Management 2.0. Broadly speaking, this is marked by vertical power structures being replaced by horizontal ones, where a more collaborative approach is taken to project management and leadership. This emerging paradigm in management is silo busting, views the organisation and its environment as a symbiotic ecosystem, and focuses more creatively on qualitative aspects like process, discovery, emergence, and innovation, instead of just on value-free, quantitative production. Anything we produce affects people's lives, including the lives of those who produce it. For instance, a mining project may be the making or the death of a community or an ecosystem, so the processes of that mining project cannot be value-free. Their value depends on how we value this community or that ecosystem. The ultimate unsustainability of the old Bronze Age way of bullying bosses and destructive processes and the devil take the hindmost is slowly but surely becoming outmoded. Don't get me wrong, there are still plenty of angry alligator bosses out there who will bite your head off if riled, but they are increasingly regarded as dinosaurs and are now clear in the crosshairs of management change, an endangered species. Mobility. One of the biggest changes in society over the past 100 years has been the increase in mobility. Who is born, lives and dies in the same village these days? Over half of us live in cities now for a start. And as a born and bred Londoner, I've seen the demography change phenomenally over the past 40 years. London is now global, like all modern cities. It's easy to see how this mobility is consistent with work-life changes and even with increased interdisciplinary and collaborative work, as we now have all the disciplines or memes of many cultures increasingly at our fingertips. Again, the connectivity principle of the electric universe hosts our increased mobility very comfortably. Communications and media technology. Marshall McLuhan coined the term of the 60s when he announced that because of the hot immediacy of instant audiovisual communications media, the world has now become a global village. Through these electronic media, we all experience the networked connectivity of the electric universe. And with digital media, it is all in binary form too. Again, totally consistent with electric universe mythology. The internet has filled the vacuum left by church and government to emerge as the organ of the people. It gives us a voice, and it is our eyes and ears. We use it to experiment and play with ideas. And most important, we use it to connect. Medicine. Medical science also looks set to become increasingly holistic. Holism means the part is equal to the whole, which certainly fits with the connectivity of the electric universe. Working with DNA is working with the blueprint of life itself. What could be more holistic than that? There is even a grudging acknowledgement by the mechanistic Bronze Age medical establishment that it's important to treat the whole person rather than just the symptoms of disease. But again, we're held back by silos, dogma, politics, and financial interests. The past few decades have also seen a huge growth in alternative holistic medicine like herbalism, homeopathy, hand healing, crystal healing, acupuncture, and so on. The demand for this kind of thing comes from a spiritual hunger, which the spiritually bankrupt Bronze Age systems cannot satisfy. If you smash a glass hologram of a man, each broken piece contains the whole image. Incredible, but true. It's a bit like Bell's theorem of faster-than-light connections. The parts of the image or information are not located anywhere, but everywhere simultaneously. When we have systems that reflect that kind of structure, we will hunger no more. Finance. The corrupted bases of financial trading stem directly from the inadequacy of Bronze Age memes to handle the complexity of the global economy. The total meltdown and bailout of the global financial system in 2008 highlighted the frailty of fiat-based currency, prompting a wide search for alternatives, including local currencies. Many towns in England now operate with their own pounds. Virtual currencies, like Bitcoin and Linden dollars, and web-based barter exchanges of labour, goods and services. We've also seen a resurgence of demand for a return to the gold standard, rooting the value of money in gold instead of in numbers created out of thin air by bankers who charge us for them making it up. The emergent mythology of electric universe suggests the surprising possibility not just of a return to a gold and silver standard, both of which metals have particular properties in relation to electrical processes, but even to amber too, for the very word electric comes from the Greek electron, meaning amber, which is magnetic, attracting light bodies when rubbed, just like iron attracts iron. Energy. The past 50 years or so have seen a big shift in our understanding of energy. Despite recent IMF figures showing $10 million of subsidies to the fossil fuel industry every minute, finite resources of fossil fuels like oil, coal and gas, and the human and environmental impact of harvesting them, are driving the need to find new, cleaner and cheaper energy. Coal is almost done. We've passed peak oil, and gas will run out too. The old fossil fuel industry now leans on the two-pointed crutch of fracking, which only shows its financial desperation and its ethical and moral bankruptcy. The corporate energy industry and its pet government stooges are locked into thinking and operating in Bronze Age terms of centralization of operations, wealth and power. They like big industrial complexes, which maintain the illusion that we need them to provide for our energy needs, as only they have the know-how and wherewithal to build plants to generate it. So their favourite alternative option to fossil fuels, the only one they put on the table, is nuclear. big plants that only they can operate secure their elite status and keep us all in their thrall. Their folly has given us Chernobyl and Fukushima. The consequences so far of these cataclysms are already bad enough to destroy the future of all life on Earth. Radiation doesn't always kill instantly. Levels of strontium, cesium, polonium and uranium in the Pacific are thousands of times above safety levels. The ocean between Japan and California is radioactive and there's no fixing that. It's just a matter of time before this affects us all. And that's just with current levels of spill in May 2015. At the moment, it looks as if Japan and the world have given up on ever stemming the flow of deadly radioactivity into the ocean. No need to worry about doomsday. It's already happened in Fukushima. A small chink of light still shines with the possibility that our planet will not become a barren, toxic waste in space. For human ingenuity has an incomparable track record for surviving against the odds. While there's life, there's hope. And while we're in with a chance of doing a Houdini, there's a whole raft of sustainable alternatives that don't destroy the planet if they go wrong. Solar, wind, and water for a start. But there's nothing more electric universe than electricity. Nikola Tesla was the genius who showed us how the world can have infinite, low-risk, free energy. Completely free for everyone, forever. 1 minute's subsidy transferred from fossil fuels to electricity would likely solve the whole world's energy needs forever. This can actually happen if we demand it. Nikola Tesla. Check him out if you haven't already. Education. Education development has been pointing towards holistic principles for a long time too, with the ideal of educating the whole child, academic, emotional, practical and social. The full adoption of this ideal is held back in much the same way as with medicine. Probably the most significant and prophetic work in education, from the point of view of the electric universe, is that of Brazilians Paulo Freire and Ivan Illich. Back in the 60s, Illich announced the deschooling of society to be replaced with autonomous, self-generating learning networks, much like the social networking of today's global village. And Freire emphasized the radically humanizing and historically transformative role of education as a practice of social, economic, and political freedom. Thus emerges the picture of paradigm shift in physics, ecology, humanities, media, interdisciplinary collaboration, work life, mobility, medicine, education, finance, and beyond, covering all aspects of connectivity in knowledge, community, and ecosystem. These paradigm shifts are like a string of lights coiled up and ready to uncurl, quick as a flash, all joined by a common ethical thread, and all fired by a shared practical need to adapt and survive. The power source is cosmology, the source of all our attempts to make meaning and the keystone of any mythology. Electric universe cosmology is the breakthrough that ties together all these mini proto-revolutions into a single ubiquitous one, with a whole new mythology, a whole new value and behavior system being lived by more and more people. Cosmology may be the power source, as Jung said, but the actual power that flows from that source is none other than creativity itself. The spirit to adapt and survive with integrity, the urge to defy corruption and emerge from the chasm of unsustainable folly in one piece. This imperative is shared by all advocates of paradigm shift, no matter the field. The net of the Hindu god Indra is strung with pearls, each reflecting all the other pearls in the net, and all containing the entire universe. Those pearls are seeds of wisdom from the fruit of the tree of knowledge. The light snakes around the tree. And as we listen and watch, it grows, and we are tempted to experience, to taste that light juice fruit. The light juice fruit spreads throughout the bush of the tree, now filled with fire, yet not consumed by it. Is the fruit of knowledge really forbidden by God? Or is it merely hidden in little clues left in plain sight by those with the biggest voice who would abuse it to exploit and oppress humanity for Bronze Age reasons? Their voice gives our power elites the means, and their proven excessive greed gives them the motive. That's all we can know. Rather than speculate about unknowable negatives, let's just get on with the doable positives. To paraphrase the philosopher Edmund Husserl, the question is not so much what can we do with electric universe cosmology and mythology, but what can electric universe cosmology and mythology do with us? Electric universe cosmology and the mythology that grows from it is the biggest sea change in human consciousness in the past 3,000 years. Heliocentric Bronze Age cosmology bred the patriarchal heroic mythology at the root of today's tragic problems. Now we are aware of a new cosmology that can generate a whole new mythology for the first time in 3,000 years. What can we do to help it grow? I think it's important to actually announce the new mythology, like Nietzsche announced the beginning of the end of Bronze Age mythology when he said God is dead. The fake morality of a defunct, outmoded mythology, so obvious to him in the 1800s, is now plain to all of us. And now we have an alternative in place. So how do we spread the word? What are the stories, and how can we tell them? Those stories are all around us already. They are the stories of the past 100 years or so, the stories of unified connectivity seen in the Mandelbrot set, in Facebook and the growth of internet connection, in the growth of holism in art, architecture, medicine, physics, in our mapping of the human genome, in cross-curricular education and the educational praxis of Paulo Freire, in psychoanalytic theory, in world music, in organic husbandry and agriculture, in Twitter and YouTube news feeds of popular social change movements, in philosophical critical theory, in Tesla's free global electric power, in Buckminster Fuller's geodesic domes. These are just a tiny sample of the myriad stories that sit waiting in the wings for the new mythology they are part of to be announced. And all those stories of social and scientific revolution need an anchoring foundation if they are to fulfill their hopeful potentials. That foundation is electric universe cosmology. Once the new cosmology gains a foothold, a new mythology will permeate society, and all these stories of paradigm shifts will become the ancient tales of the future. As we move through this transformation, we must announce our emergence from the stifling chrysalis of Bronze Age darkness towards a whole new age of human development through the new mythology of connectivity, of the electric universe. We must tell and live the stories that reflect it, and we must denounce the Bronze Age mythology of global pillage and plunder by a tiny power elite whose greatest fear is historical change. We do that by questioning and rejecting the values, actions, structures, and systems that perpetuate Bronze Age mind. This process of announcing and denouncing is more powerful than it might seem, for it is actually the start of dialogue by which history is made and reality transformed. Where the narrative of story meets the dialogue of change is the sweet spot where the magic happens. That's where mythologies are born. As long as we denounce the Bronze Age and announce the paradigm shifts that comprise electric universe mythology, we're doing our bit right there. We create and transform reality by how we frame it and speak of it, and that's what human connection is for. The butterfly emerging from that chrysalis signifies the freedom of the human consciousness from the growing pains of Bronze Age torment, for the butterfly is the symbol of the Greek goddess Psyche, whose name means soul. Denouncing and announcing is how we bring new realities about. Without the announcement of a new cosmology, such as electric universe, all the stories of longed-for change can never accrue into an actual mythology and can therefore never add up to a complete shift in human condition. So far, this is our best shot at a new mythology. And nothing short of a new mythology is required for us to make that leap to a new sustainable society. And make no mistake about it, A new mythology can solve the wicked problems we face. In fact, it may even be the only thing that can. Racism, sexism, the wealth gap, the media machine, the energy industry, the military-industrial complex, and so on, are all rooted in Bronze Age mythology. Their branches permeate society like reverse lightning, with instant effects everywhere, an image which only serves to show how they contain the seed of their own transformation, like a magnetic force pulling them towards equilibrium, for there are none so oppressed or so in need of liberation as the oppressors themselves. Such deformities of the human spirit cannot withstand the change of mythology that electric universe theory brings. The challenges are big, but there is something simple and concrete that we can do that will bring about historical change. And this is it. Announcing this and denouncing that is the very process by which history is made. That's the whole reason why I'm making this video announcement, to open up discussion of this unique and long-awaited window of opportunity. With physics, ecology, education, and so on, the arch is almost ready. It just needs the keystone to be put in place. All we have to do is announce and denounce. Have those conversations. The more we denounce tragic Bronze Age mythology and announce connective electric universe mythology, the weaker the whole Bronze Age spell will become. This short video has been my small contribution towards that process. Thank you for listening, and I hope you found it interesting, useful, and enjoyable. Stay connected. The best is yet to come.
But I know a change gon' come.